bean bag?
Yeah.
No, but don't
be bad. Hank a bean bag
there? Those Joe Bart?
They are not. They are,
Hello? Chickity chick chick, can you hear me? Do I even need this thing?
Everyone always asks about these pickups. And they look like Joe Barden pickups. I was in a music shop in Karlsruhe, Germany. Karlsruhe. And I saw a telly with these pickups in it. I said, hey, are those Joe Bardens? And they said, no, it's this guy, Ray Gerald. I said, who the hell is Ray Gerald? And then I noticed this little toggle switch that was on the guitar. And I said, well, let me try those out. So what's cool about them is that they're always hum canceling, but there's a single coil mode where they sound single coil, but they're always quiet. And then you can hit them and they actually become humbuckers. They get a little thicker and they sound really good. And I thought they were cool. And I said, well, how much are they? And they were like 350 euro or something like that. I was like, I said, they're cool, but they're not that cool. You know what I'm saying? So I departed. And then about 3 weeks later, I was at Music Mesa, or Music Mess, as we like to refer to it. And I went in there, and this guy came up to me and said, I heard you like my pickups. I said, yeah, they're great. And he goes, well, I've got a soldering iron. Give me your guitar, and I'll pop them in. So he did, and I've had them in there ever since. They sound great. And I'm in the midst of a three-week tour over here with my band. And we're getting towards the end of the tour, so I'm a little out of it. So if I seem a little weird today, it's completely normal. Anyway. But I had to bring one guitar, so I brought this one because I knew that no matter what club I would be in, that if there was any problems with 60 cycle hum, that these pickups would combat it. Now I should say that when I first bought this guitar, and I did buy it, you know, everyone thinks that, you know, being, you know, doing stuff for Fender over the years, that I get any guitar I want for free. Of course that's true. No, I'm just kidding. Usually what happens is that that's not the case. So if I really want something, I have to pay for it. And I was just looking for, at the time, I just wanted a production line guitar that I could play, that I didn't care if it got beat up or if it got stolen or whatever. I just wanted a workhorse guitar that I could travel with. So I bought an American Deluxe Ash Tele. And the reason why I liked it is because, yes, regular single coils sound the best. However, when you're playing every night of the week and sometimes you're set up next to a popcorn machine and the electronic wiring is horrible and you have horrible 60 cycle hum, it's nice to be able to escape. And so this guitar originally had the SCN pickups in it, which I actually really liked. And what I liked about them most is not only were they totally quiet, but they looked like regular single coils. It looked like a regular Tele pickup in here and a regular, you know, six pole piece, you know, bridge pickup. So I really liked it. And the only reason why I popped these pickups in is because I got them for free. But they sound great. I mean, they really do sound good. And I like having this extra option of getting humbuckers. I will say that the S1 switch that usually comes on these guitars, there's usually a button here on your volume control that allows you to get the middle combination. Instead of being in parallel, it goes into series. And it also adds like a little bit of a boost. I did use that quite a bit when I play slide. I like to have a little thicker tone. So it was cool to have that, but now I just make the pickups humbuckers when I'm playing slide. That's the same thing. Sorry, before we began the clinic, we started talking, so don't be shy. I think there's a few seats left in here somewhere. There's a couple up front here if you guys want to come in. I've been touring around using a 65 super reverb reissue, which I really like quite a bit. I suppose I should play a little something, then we'll talk. Should I wait until 1 o'clock or should I just start? I'm feeling a little rebellious. Thank you. You know, even though we're at a guitar convention, and it's all about gear, and gear is extraordinarily fun, but you know what? 99% of someone's tone comes from your hands, ladies and gentlemen. It's 99%. That 1% is critical and can be a lot of fun and can be very expensive, but it's 1%. If it ain't here, it ain't happening. So, as I like to say, if you've practiced a lot and so on and so forth and you don't like your tone, then come here and find something to help you out. But if you're not practicing and you're not satisfied with your tone, all the gear in the world ain't gonna help you out. You know what I'm saying? So if you want a good tone, you gotta work for it. Who knows what I'm talking about? Identify yourselves. All right, fair enough. Okay. Today, what I play gigs at home, I like to have is, you know, now that I'm 47 years old, I went through the stage of, you know, I did a ton of sessions and playing with different bands, and I would have this big pedal board because you never know, especially in studio situations, you know, when the producer's going to say, is there something that you can make your guitar sound like an orc, you know, doing battle in the mines of Moria? And then you go, well, I got that right over here. And you step on it, and the more buttons flashing, like, that sounds excellent, you know? But as an artist, as someone doing my own music, I like to have as little stuff in the chain as possible. So it's usually a tele, a cord, and an amplifier. And if the amp has a little vibrato on it or tremolo, excellent. When I'm in the studio, I like to use real Leslie speakers as much as I can. But back home, I've been playing a lot with a keyboard player, plays great organ. That sounds kind of dirty. He's a good organ player. Wait a minute, that sounds dirty as well. But his name is Theo Merriweather, which I think is the greatest keyboard player name of all time. You know what I mean? It's like when you grow up with a name like Theo Merriweather, it's almost like preordained you're going to play Hammond B3 at a Baptist church. You know what I'm saying? Anyway, so at home, I haven't, you know, I've basically just been going with a really pure tone because I got an organ player, you know, doing all the nice textures. But I've been touring over here with my band. I thought, well, I got to cover the organ parts. So I took out my old, my current favorite Leslie simulator. Now, for years, I had used, I used a lot of different stuff. I used to use a Korg G4 back in the day. Remember those things? It's brown unit. And I remember Warren Haynes from Government Mule was using one. I was like, that's cool. That sounds good. I'll try that one. And I used that for years. And what I liked about that was is that its slow speed sounded really good. The high sounded good, too. It didn't quite have the nice, pristine, high-end stuff that you associate with a regular Leslie, but it was close. And then I got the Hughes and Kettner Rotosphere, which I thought was really cool. It sounds good fast. It's got a nice, shimmering high-end, but the slow gets a little funky. It starts to sound a little, I don't know, not as transparent as perhaps I liked. And then I tried this pedal here, which I think sounds great. Not too many people know about this, but it's a German-made pedal. I love it when I'm playing in Germany, people come up to me, what is this Leslie simulator? And I said, well, it's this German pedal called the Ven. No one knows what this pedal is in Germany. It's like, you know, the marketing team for this company should be lined up and shot. Sorry. Sorry, is it too soon? I'm sorry. Anyway, but this pedal is, it's called the Neo Instruments Ventilator. And so it's got this... type sound, and then I usually like to just turn amps up and use the volume control on my guitar to go between clean and dirty, crazy me, and my favorite current amps that Fender has to do that with, although I have used the Supersonic 60 I used on a record I did with Malford Milligan. It was, we did a live thing called Live on the Radio, and I used a Supersonic combo with a 212 extension cabinet, and that really sounded good. But there's an amp that Fender started making in 1996 called the Custom Vibrolux. Does anyone know about this amp? Yeah, I love Vibroluxes. They sound killer. They're the right wattage, and I'm a huge Roy Buchanan fan, and that's like the greatest advertisement for a Vibrolux of all time. Him and Danny Gatton, and the telly threw a Vibrolux. Done. You know what I mean? That's all you need. And this amp really sounds good because it's not like a blackface Vibrolux. It's a little bit more kind of like a combination between a tweed amp and a blackface amp. And the fact that, you know, you go into the first channel, it's got a volume, a treble, and a bass. Much like this first channel. I like this. All it needs, my favorite amp would actually have one knob that says more. You know what I mean? Just be done, you know. The more knobs it has, I have no time for that. So with the Vibrolux, what's nice is I can just plug straight into that thing, turn it up to about 7, and then you turn the volume down on the guitar, it's nice and glassy and clean, you turn it up and it starts screaming like a banshee in heat. And that's a good thing, as far as I'm concerned. Another one I like to do that with is a tweed basement. Now, a little trick for tweed basements that I discovered years ago that really works out well is on a Fender amp, I love the sound of the bright switch for clean chordal stuff. You got that nice shimmering high end. Especially on the older amps, it works better. But on the newer amps, they need to be broken in a little bit. So when you turn that bright switch on and you add any kind of distortion, it's kind of like an ice pick in the forehead, or like, as I like to say, a blizzard of nails. You know what I'm saying? It's like you're being attacked by this high-end frequency. So what I like to do is I learned this little trick, is that what you can do is I turn the bright switch on, I turn the treble all the way off, and I put the mids all the way up. And then I add a little bit of the bass, and then I'll add a little bit of treble if I need it. But that's how I run a basement. So if you go into a tweed basement, and you go into the bright channel, just try this if you've never done it, a 59 or 58, 59 basement reissue. Go into the bright channel, and turn the mids all the way up, turn the presence all the way up, turn the treble off, and then maybe just a little bit of bass, and then turn that amp up to about 7. And if that isn't Plexiville, I don't know what is. If you look at a Marshall over here, it's like you're looking down at the front end, at the top of a basement, because all they did with Marshalls is they basically made Fender basement, tweed basement amps, and they added some English parts and so on and so forth. So a basement is great, because it's 410s, you plug straight into that beast, turn it up like I said, and all you have to do is work the volume knob on your guitar, and it's like the greatest sound of rock of all time. You know, it's not too over-distorted, it's just natural overdrive of power amp tubes begging for mercy, right? But in lieu of that, when I'm traveling over here with my band, there's no way in hell I'm going to be able to turn up an amp to that volume. So I like to use an overdrive pedal in those instances. And a friend of mine years ago, a guy by the name of Tim Yarning, made a pedal for me called, first he had this clean boost pedal called the Luxury Drive. And then he came up with an overdrive and he sent it to me. And he goes, well, if you like this, we'll make it your signature overdrive. He goes, what should we call it? And I said, well, let's call it the Diabolical Gristle Tone Manipulator. He said, perfect. So we called it the DGTM for short. So we had the DGTM, and then we had this Luxury Drive clean boost. And I said, well, why don't we put those two pedals together? And that was called the Gristle King. And we made them ourselves from my website, from his website, we would sell them. And then years ago, a T-Rex made them for a period of time. They made both the DGTM and they made the Gristle King. And then that ended, and now we're making them again ourselves. And then Tim changed the circuit, he changed the clean boost, a little bit more transparent, the lead sounds a little creamier. But one of the things about the Gristle King is that it's a clean boost and it's an overdrive, but there were these three toggle switches on it. And I only use the toggle switches in a certain way, and if I'm doing a gig and I inadvertently hit one of those toggle switches, it used to really piss me off. So I said, Tim, just set it the way I like it and then remove the toggle switches. So we did that, now it's got 4 knobs on it, so it's coming close to heaven. You know, the one. But, so basically what it is it's a, I'll set my amp to, this is only a 22 watt amp. You know, usually if I'm traveling with a super reverb, I'll put it on about 4. And then, you know, with the bright on and the mids all the way up. And I've got the bass on about 4 and the treble on about 3 on my super. This amp, I'm going into the first channel, which I have on the Vibrolux setting. Pretty much straight up. I got the treble and bass at 12 o'clock. So this is just the amp. It's a good little crunchy little tone. If I want a little bit more with the clean boost, the amp with a little bit of the clean boost on. Now on top of that, I never really use the overdrive by itself, or very infrequently. I usually just add it to go on top of the clean boost. So here's just amp. Here's the clean boost. Here's the overdrive. sounds under the rainbow. So if I want like a clean blues-ish thing, I just turn the volume down on the guitar.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Some random stupidity. There you go. Okay, usually at these clinics, I kind of give you a little tutorial on chicken picking, and I'm going to do that quick here while we got time. We got plenty of time. Okay. First of all, why a Telecaster? When I first started playing, I think my first electric guitar was actually a Lotus Les Paul. You know what I'm saying? They were really cheap at the time. But my first real electric guitar, and I saw one downstairs, was a Fender Lead 1. This is in 1979. It had that single humbucker. But the first, you know, what I really wanted was a Strat, because I was a huge Hendrix fanatic, you know, Derek and the Dominoes, you're a Clapton fan, and I wanted the sound of a Strat. But my guitar teacher at the time had like a 1968 Telecaster. It was blonde. And he was selling it, and I got it for like $400 at the time, and I just loved the sound of that neck pickup on the Tele. You know, this was like, oh my God, this sounds so good. I wanted that sound. And then I just grew up playing that guitar, so it wasn't like all my favorite players are at that time. All my favorite players are Tele. I want to belong to the Tele cult. You know, it wasn't that. It was like, here's a tool that I was, you know, exposed to and started using, and figured out that it was the guitar for me. So I played that Tele for quite some time, and I've used different guitars over the years. For years, I just played a Strat. In my college years, I played a 335, as you do when you're in jazz world. You know, you want something with a little more. So, but I always had a Tele in the arsenal. And then probably about 10 years ago, even though I was still playing Teles quite a bit, but Strat was my main guitar, I just thought, you know what, screw it. I just want to play a Telecaster because I play really hard. You know, I bend strings, you know, two whole steps, and I'm, you know, bending the neck and doing all kinds of crazy stuff. And I'm not a real guitar tech guy. I don't know how to take apart a guitar. I guess a screwdriver is involved, from what I understand. You open it up somewhere. I don't want to know. I don't want to know how to set up a guitar. I know how to adjust a truss rod if I have to. But for the most part, I hand it off to somebody. I just want to play them. So for me, a Telecaster is a guitar that I can abuse. And it's going to work for me. It's going to stay in tune. It's going to sound great. You can do chicken picking. You can play blues on it. You can play rock. You can use it as a home security device and hit somebody with it, and they're never going to get up again. It's the all-purpose guitar. You know, you really can't screw up a Telecaster. And I've also realized that I tend to like ash bodies. Ash wood seems to have a little bit more of a pop to it. And I like maple necks for the same reason. They've just got a more... as I said, more pop, more brightness to them. And especially as I get older and lose all the high-end frequency in my ears, it's good to have a guitar that I can still hear. Who knows what I'm talking about? Let's deaf people reunite. Anyway, exactly what? So, you know, I'd always played kind of chicken picking stuff anyways on Strats, and, you know, even when I played my 335 back in the day, I always did my chicken picking stuff. But I didn't grow up listening to country music. You know, where I'm from in the States, I'm from Milwaukee, which is in the north. And my older brothers, I was the youngest of seven kids. And so I'm kind of a hippie by default because my older siblings were all hippies, right? So I grew up listening to Hendrix and Cream and the Allman Brothers Band and the James Gang and these types of people. And the only reason why I started getting, I heard the sound of chicken picking through Mark Knopfler from Dire Straits. You know, I heard Sultans of Swing, you know. I got to get me some of that. And also, whenever he would play like a rock and roll pattern, it was never always like. It was always. There was always that bucka 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 thing going on, right? And then right around the same time, I knew about Albert Lee. The only reason why I knew about Albert Lee is because he played in Eric Clapton's band, and Eric Clapton had that record that was recorded in 1979 and came out in 1980 called Just One Night, and which was kind of a weird thing because Clapton was using a kind of a cleaner Strat tone at that time, I think in response to Mark Knopfler, and then he had Albert Lee in the band, and so Clapton was doing kind of this more kind of clean, cool thing, and then Albert Lee was just, you know, I heard this guy and he was doing these little... I heard that, I was like, holy shit, that's not the blues scale. What's going on there? You know, this, you know, so I started to get into Albert Lee and Mark Knopfler. I was like, well, these guys didn't just do it. They must have got it from somewhere. So when I started researching Albert Lee, I would always see the same names. I'd see James Burton, Jerry Reed, Jimmy Bryant, and all. So I began this quest, and I started getting into all these guys. And then right around the same time, I'm listening to guys like Roy Buchanan, and then I got exposed to Danny Gatton early on because a friend of mine was this kind of a well-known music writer in the States, and I played in a band with his younger brother. And he was home, he lived in New York, and he was home, and he heard me playing. He's like, man, if you're into that chicken picking stuff, you need to hear this guy, Danny Gatton. So then he burned me a tape of the first two solo records of Danny Gatton. So I got exposed to that stuff early on. I was like, it was like a buffet of licks to steal. And so I started getting into these guys. But when I first did the chicken picking thing, I did it with my thumb and my first finger. And I would stash my pick in between my first and middle fingers here. And I'd just kind of go in between. I'd go... There's always that split second thing before I switch my pick back and forth. And whenever I show this at clinics, people are like, oh, ooh, ooh. I didn't even know this was a thing. I just had to whip my pick over, you know? I was like, you know, what are you going to do? So I just put my pick in between my first two knuckles of my first finger and middle finger. And then when I need it, I just kind of go like this and go back and forth. It's really not that big of a deal, but... You know, just after years of doing it, you just go, you know, thinking about it, you know. But all the chicken picking I did with my thumb and my first finger. And to simplify it, what it basically is if this is the string of the guitar, I put my first finger down on the string, just kind of muting it with the first finger. And then the thumb goes on the same string, a little bit more towards where the neck pickup would be. And then the thumb plucks a note that's muted because your first finger's behind it, so you get this... That's a technical term. You get this thud. And then right after you pluck this muted note, you lift that string up and it pops. So between this thud and this pop, the chicken takes flight. So if I do it on a guitar, I'm going to put my first finger in between the two pickups. And then I'm going to put my thumb down, as I said, a little bit more towards the neck pick. I'm just doing it on an A string. And the thumb plucks a note. You just get this big old thud. Just down here a little bit. And then I lift up with that first finger, and I get the pop. So between the two, I get this. Now, the muted note isn't necessarily completely muted. Sometimes you can still hear the note. But you're still getting that effect, this chicken picking. So what I recommend people do at first, they're like... Because it's difficult at first. It's kind of, you know, especially if you're just used to playing a pick. At first it can be a little troubling. So what you can do is just, you know, as you're sitting around watching TV, you can just be going, start at the low E string. Switch to the A string. D string. G string, so on and so forth. So you're getting some kind of fluidity of doing 16th notes, right? Or some kind of a triplet. Whatever. And once you get that going, then you can do stuff like take a blues scale. Like I always pick the A blues scale because it's right in the middle of the neck. And most everyone knows the blues scale, right? Because it's our express way to improvisation. It's like every time you want to learn, it's like... that scale and you're good to go, right? So it's just a minor pentatonic scale with an added flatted fifth. Okay, the blues scale. And I'm going to chicken pick every one of those notes. So we just... So then with just that much information, you can take, let's just take like a simple blues lick, like a. And all of a sudden we can go. Anything you play is going to have that. Sometimes you just bend one string and chicken pick it. Okay. Before I get into the hybrid pick, and this is, I also like, I'm a huge Albert Collins fan. Any Albert Collins fans out there?
Yes, the Iceman cometh.
And his licks always sounded weird because he's in this tuning. He's in like an F minor tuning, and then whenever he wants to switch keys, he just brings the capo up and down. It's very, very odd. But to try to get some of his licks done, I just had to figure out what they were. And I'll do them with this chicken picking technique. And of course, Albert Collins was not a country music artist. I don't know if you're aware of that. And so you can get a lot of use out of this kind of technique that's not necessarily, you know, as I like to say, redneck oriented. So you can do a little. Just that idea of popping up on that string, that whole idea of that. You know, the mute, and then actually lifting up the string and popping it, you get this. All that kind of stuff. You just get a lot more expression out of the instrument when you use your hands on the guitar. You know what I'm saying? But then what was happening is that I would always have to, it would take me a split second between going from my thumb and first finger to the pick. And I knew a lot of guys that I was really into, I was a fan of, were guys that used pick and fingers together. James Burton being one, Danny Gatton certainly, and Roy Buchanan. So I had to figure out how to do it, and it was not pleasant trying to figure this out. It took a while. For one thing, you need a little bit of a nail. Some people get into like using the fake fingernails, and they got them really long, and I don't personally see the need for that. I mean, obviously it works for some people, but all I know is that if I have a little bit of a nail, I got enough to pop the string. So even like I broke this nail, my middle fingernail, the other day, and it really doesn't matter. As long as I got this much nail showing above the cuticle, I can still pop the strings, and that's all I care about. So this chicken picking with the, first I'll get in just with the chicken picking with the pick and the finger. It's the same basic technique that I did with the thumb and the first finger, like this. But now what you're going to do is you're going to put your middle finger down on the string, and the nail of that middle finger is what's going to be muting that string, okay? And then your pick, being held by your first finger and your thumb, is going to hit a note that's muted, but it's going to have a lot more of a metallic sound to it because that nail is holding the string, so you get this kind of a ping. And then you lift up that string with the nail and pop it back down, and it sounds like this. More of a warmer tone and doesn't quite have the machine gun attack as opposed to the pick and finger. So I'll go in between the two depending on what I'm doing. If I'm doing some kind of, you know, chicken picking, I'll usually use the pick and fingers good. So when I'm doing the faster silliness, I'll use the pick and the finger together. If I'm doing the bluesier stuff, I'll usually always use the fingers. But now getting into using more than just your middle finger, that took a while. So I got into playing, you know, banjo rolls and all of this stuff. And again, I didn't grow up with an Uncle Billy Bob that knew all the Chet Atkins songs that sat me down going, "Here, Junior, let me show you how it's done." None of that happened, okay? I didn't know anybody that knew Chet. The first Chet records I had were the ones that he released in the 80s. There was one called Stay Tuned that had Mark Knopfler on it and Steve Lukather and Larry Carlton and that kind of stuff. I thought it was a great record. And it was, you know, and there was cool stuff in there. I learned my first sweep lick. It was actually, I learned that from Chet Atkins. You know, everyone was getting into Yngwie and all these. I didn't know those guys from Adam. I knew that Chet went. I was like, oh, Chester's a badass. So, and then I would start to hear some of the older Chet stuff. And I would hear Merle Travis and these guys. And it depressed the hell out of me. And then I did go to school for music. And I went to college. I majored in jazz guitar, but I really majored in beer. You know what I'm saying? It was a course of study I took very seriously, I might add. And there was a guy there that I knew would, he had an Uncle Billy Bob, and who shot him out of. Doing that Chet Atkins or Merle Travis type stuff was not going to happen. So what I found was over the years, as I started using these other fingers, I was able to kind of break myself into doing this stuff. So one of the ways of just kind of practicing getting your other fingers involved is I always just show people this little, you know, just getting used to using your other fingers by doing these little banjo rolls. Down here, but I'm going pick on the low E string, middle finger on the A string, and then third finger on the D string, and just doing a triplet. And then switching to the next string set. I am kind of loosening up on the pressure down here to make those a little bit more staccato. And then going between the two. Time to get those fingers used to working. Thank you. And then I started getting into some, I would hear Chet Atkins do certain things, and I had to learn how to do it. And at first, picking it off records was impossible for me, because it just didn't make sense. Because all I listened to was like blues guys and some jazz guys and, you know, chicken picking licks. But when you're hearing, you know, three parts going on at one time, figuring that out from the record is incomprehensible, especially if you're not seeing someone do it. If I had a teacher there, I was like, well, you're playing like this here, but like, oh, okay, you know. So I do a lot of work with the Hal Leonard Publishing Company. I've written a bunch of books and DVDs and stuff for them. It's made me the thousandaire I am today, ladies and gentlemen. And one day as I was looking at their catalog, I saw this group of transcriptions, this Chet Atkins transcription book. I'm like, well, I'll get that. They're probably not right. You know what I mean? You always have this feeling that they're not going to be like what Chet actually played, right? And then I got it, and I started working through it, and I was like, holy shit, this is the real deal. So I figured out one from a transcription, and then it was like opening up the whole floodgates for me, and I realized how to start figuring this stuff out. And it's been fun. I mean, the Chet stuff's interesting because all the music that I'm attracted to play and to listen to is usually improvised. And what Chet does, and what Jerry Reed did, what wasn't really improvised. They could improvise, but most of their songs were worked out from start to finish, and there would be little aspects or interpretations of the arrangements that they would do. But for the most part, they're through composed things. You know what I mean by that? So it was a different world for me. But once I got in, I really enjoyed it, and it's a lot of fun. Even now, when I have some time on my hand, which is never, I'll start, you know, learning, you know, a new tune, a new Chet tune or something like that. Because they're really, I mean, Chet to me is the ultimate example of ultimate technique with ultimate accessibility. You know what I mean? Everything he played was, they were pop tunes. And people, you know, you didn't have to be a great guitar player to go, oh, I like that song. You know what I mean? He was very accessible from a listener standpoint. But what he's doing on guitar is just insane. And to that extent, that's what, you know, what Tommy Emmanuel does. He took the Chet thing and brought it into the next one. But it's all Chet stuff. I mean, Chet did it all. You know what I mean? It's like he's all the Chet, all whatever. And then, of course, you know, all the different cascading harmonics. And Lenny Bro took that. And so Tommy's kind of an amalgam of all those guys doing that stuff. He's like Chetzilla. You know what I mean? But so I started working on some of those stuff. And I'll do this little arrangement for you that I came up with. Part of it is arrangements that Chet did. Some of it's stuff I came up with a little bit. And, you know, put together with being a wise ass. And that's been fun. Turn around and see the boy, and he's rocking. So that's fun. The other guys. They're all good. It's fun with the band traveling around. Questions? Don't be afraid.
What type of strings do you use?
Strings. I always say, people ask me what kind of strings I use, I say without question, free ones. You know what I'm saying? I use 10 through 46. And I use D'Addario's or Fender's. They're kind of very similar. And that's what I like to use. I did switch to 11s for years. And I like the idea of playing 11 through, I think it's 58 is the bottom string, I can't remember. Whatever the standard 11 set is. I did it for two reasons. Three reasons. I wanted the guitar to stay in tune better. I liked the tone of bigger strings, and I wanted it to kind of make me think about what I was playing more instead of just going, Skoo! And the last part didn't work because I just got used to it. I went, anyway, but they did sound really good, and they stayed in tune better, and I really dug it. I dug playing 11s on my Strats and Teles and everything else, but the problem was is that if I had to travel someplace and grab a Fender guitar off the wall that had 9s on it, and then it was like, you know what I mean? It was so hard to switch gears and get used to playing 9s again. So I just went back to 10s as kind of a, you know, because a lot of the Fender guitars come with 10s now. Sometimes they come with 9s, depending. I don't know. There's no standard logic, I don't think. But then I'm used to it. So I use 10s, and they're fine, you know. And on a Tele, I brought this one guitar for this tour, and my thought has always been, if you get two full nights on a set of strings of an all-night gig, you know, where you're playing, you know, pretty hard, two nights, good, third night, pushing it, fourth night, really pushing it. So I find myself changing strings about after every three gigs. Not so much that I'm worried about breaking strings, although there is that, but they just don't sound right. I remember when I was a kid, I would only change strings when I broke one. You know what I mean? It's like, I thought, well, you don't change them, you just replace them. You know what I mean? So it was weird for me, and then I would put new strings on, and I was like, God, it sounds horrible. It's all bright. You know, I liked them with like a layer of soot on them, you know what I mean? But now, of course, I'm like, well, of course you have to have new strings on, because that's what I base my whole sound on. So now I find every three gigs I got to be replacing strings. And one thing I will say, this may be obvious to probably 90% of you, but for the 10% that don't know this trick, let me just tell you that if you want your guitar to stay in tune quicker after you change strings, don't, and then guitar players are very, very, I'm going to say ritualistic. You know what I mean? It's like a lot of, I'm going to change my strings now, and I get out my special blanket, and I put on the table with my little neck holder, and I put on some Ravi Shankar, and I put some incense on, and my special ointment, and my rag, and I take all the strings off at once, and the guitar just goes, because you've just taken hundreds of pounds of pressure off in one fell swoop. You know, guitars do not like this. They're not into that. So what I realize, especially with Strats, is that when I change strings, I keep the guitar in tune. I take one string off, I put the new string on, I tune it up, I yank on it a few times, it goes out of string, you know, about three yanks, and it's staying in tune. Then I go on to the next string. If you change strings that way and change them one at a time, keeping the guitar in tune the whole time, you could change strings 10 minutes before a gig and you're good. The old way of taking all the strings off and then putting this, you're messing, there's too many variables. You want to keep the tension on the neck and on the guitar as much the same as possible. This is my own personal observations. I don't know if there's science to back it up, but it works. So try that. If you're not doing that, try it, and I think you'll be like, oh my God, I can change strings now right before a gig and not have to spend an hour, you know, playing it, yanking it, and so on and so forth. So try that. And now I will say that it makes things a little dirtier down here because you got to be a little more adventurous about how you clean the guitar. But you know what? As far as I'm concerned, where there's dirt, there's tone. You know what I'm saying? little trade secret there for you. Questions? Don't be afraid. Yes, sir.
Pedal steel licks. Yeah. How to find them?
Some I've made up. Some I've just out not stolen, as you do. I do play B-bender. The only reason why I don't play B-bender all the time is because it kind of hurts my back, to be honest with you. And so I've learned There's a bunch of them that I've just learned how to do without the B-bender, but I'll show you a couple that I've been doing as of late that I've been grooving on. A few years back, I did this James Burton Guitar Festival, and I played a couple tunes with James, and as we were during the rehearsal, I heard James do the thing where he went, oh, I'll be stealing that immediately. Actually, he did this. He went, that sounds cool as hell. So I just saw what he was doing. If I'm in the key of A, he's taking this ninth chord, and actually he's just got the third on the A string at the fourth fret, the seventh note at the D string at the fifth fret, and he's got the G string at the fourth fret on the ninth. And he just pre-bends it like a half step, and then brings it back down. It sounds cool as hell, right? So. Well, that's juicy. I thought, well, as long as you're bending three notes, you might as well bend four. So I put my pinky on the B string, and I bend that up as well. And bend the whole lot. Bend it up. And do that. And then I thought, well, it would sound even cooler with kind of a volume swell into it. So now I put the volume down, pre-bend that whole chord, hit it, and then do the volume. I've always done this one. This one is a, if I'm in A, well, I'll do it up in D. Do this seventh chord. Actually, I'll switch to E here. So here's E, bar chord at the seventh fret. I'll do this ninth chord. Now what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna bend that G string up a whole step. It's kind of a sexy one, but a lot of times what I'll do is I'll ramp up to it from here. So I'll go. So it's. That's going the other way with this chord. That's going down a half step. And then bending up. Gotta do it fast. Add the vibrato before it's obvious that you've bent one string not quite in tune. That's why with strats it's nice to have that. I always have a floating bridge, is I'll do a chord like that and I'll just add a little vibrato on there like Jeff Beckery. You do it. That's the other thing, this is a great one. If you're doing. So that is, I'm up here at the 12, 30, 40, 50, 16. 16, I'm in the key of E. I'm on the G string at the 16th fret and the E string. And then I go down to the 11th fret and bend those up. And this one is. That's just a classic. String at the 13th fret. Shit. I was never a tapper, can you tell? No. Thank you. And because this one's such a beast to play, I've kind of, you know, done a way of doing with it so I don't have to tap it. And then I'll do other little things like this is just a good one. So I'm an E. Do this little major walk up. Here's one, this is a Jerry Donahue one. I can't take any credit for this whatsoever, other than that's a bitch to play. So that one is you're in E, and you're going, but then you're grabbing the G string. And when you go up on the G string, you're catching the B string. You bend that up, the other one goes down. There's another good one. I actually stole this from Ray Flack. Ray Flack was an English guitar player. He still is, as far as I know. He's an English guitar player that played with Ricky Skaggs in the 80s. And I heard him a bunch of stuff from him. Him and Albert Lee were my two first favorites. And he would do this little ascending stuff where if like if he's an E. Just kind of bending stuff. So I could be more improvisational. That's why I didn't get into a bunch of the modern country guys do all these open string licks that are kind of set in stone. I mean, you can do some improvising with them, but they're like, okay, I got my open string run in E, you know, I've got my open string run in D, my open string run, and they'll have like four variations and they'll put them in. I'm not into a bunch of those, so I do some like, but I'll usually improvise over like, I like just putting the open strings in there at odd places, like, you know, and starting licks like a half step down, like if I'm an A. I'm starting to just. This is kind of like an Elmore James, like as done without the slide. And that's just basically taking this part of a bending half step down. Keep it as improvisatory as possible. There are certain licks that I know, okay, I'm going to do that thing now. You know what I mean? But I try to keep it as improvisatory as possible. So I never do the same thing twice. So yeah. I mean, as I said, it's impossible not to have your little
favorites.
Yeah. You know what I mean? But I think of it as being conversational. You know, if you learn a bunch of new big words, you know, when you're speaking, you're not just going to use them in everyday sentence. You know, like when you're going up to the counter, you're not going to, when you're ordering coffee, just say, you know, whatever, blurt out some million-dollar words just for the hell of it. So it's the same thing with improvising. It's like, you know, a lot of us, when we learn a big word, we feel like we got to try to use it as much as possible. It's the same thing with a new lick. It's like, oh, I learned this new thing. I'm going to throw it in every song possible. So I try to remain conversational with my playing, so that when I'm playing, yes, I'm going to use some of the old words that I use, which I do when I speak, and you're going to use your past participles and your nouns and your adverbs. You just try to be interesting with your guitar vocabulary as you are with your speaking vocabulary, if that makes sense. All right, folks, I'm going to go down to the Fender booth, and there's a little, what's the name of that?
Four Sound.
Yes, Four Sound. I'll be at that area there, and I've got some new CDs to sell there. If you want to come on down, if you just want to say hello, I'll be down there afterwards. Thank you very much.